Hi, kittens. Okay, it's just not the same. What can I possibly say about this next creator? He is the voice of all our sinful thoughts, the instructor for our kink class. He pushes us to our limit, and when we think we can't go further, his shaky breath tells us we can, and should, and definitely will. He makes you work for it. He changes us at our core with every new audio he drops. He owns our minds, our bodies, and a lot of orgasms. He's been on Quinn for 2 years, and the first time we heard him, he wished us a happy birthday with his audio birthday surprise. His most played audio, Rough Return, has over 180,000 listens. And right now he is just shy of 4.5 million total plays. His creativity and writing are unparalleled. He is engaging. He is talented. He is thoughtful. He loves his tea and honey. He is Sweet Moose's dad. And he makes us completely feral every time we hear his voice. And just when you think, there's no way we could love him more, right? You learn he's a champion for women's rights. When he opened his merch site recently, he dedicated the proceeds to ARC Southeast, whose mission is to provide funding and logistical support to individuals in Alabama, Florida, Georgia, Mississippi, South Carolina, and Tennessee, and to ensure those individuals receive safe and compassionate reproductive care. And if you haven't seen that link on his site, I have put it on my link tree, along with some others that desperately need our support. He is a self-proclaimed tattooed gutter punk with too many fantasies. But really, can you have too many fantasies when it comes to him? I don't think so. He is our sound side piece, the voice we could listen to all day. And admittedly, sometimes do. Please enjoy my chat with Bad Influence.
Okay, we are live. Hang on one moment. Excuse that. I hope you don't mind. You might have to endure a little bit of sexy tea drinking ASMR this morning. It is, it's a bit dry on the East Coast, as is, the norm. So I, a habitual tea drinker with a nonstop supply of honey. Anyway, I have not really read the questions that have been sent to me ahead of time because I want this to sound as authentic and off the cuff as possible. As such, I am sorry if I ramble a little bit. I find that in expressing my thoughts in real life, I am actually, I get a little flustered sometimes because I am not very decisive in my verbosity, and so I end up just making very inconcise, rambling streams of consciousness. So, sorry if that happens. I am probably going to keep this brief because I do have a dog at home waiting for me. But let's get it started. Let me grab another sip. This is also on a microphone that I have not used before, so hopefully this doesn't sound bad. Hi. Hi, this is Milo, otherwise known as Bad Influence, or your sound side piece on Quinn, the app and website. I'm happy to be here to have a sit down with comments on Quinn, to answer a couple of questions for the listeners, and hopefully bring up a little bit more visibility for ARC Southeast, the organization that means a lot to me. It supports female reproductive rights in the southeastern states of America. In the future months, when my merch finally eventually goes up, all proceeds of merch do go straight to them. So That's enough of that. Okay, let's move on. Question number one. Yeah? All right. How did I get started in this industry, either with Quinn and or voice acting? It's a good question. I get asked that a lot. There's a long version and a short version. Short version is I've been trying to be an actor and filmmaker since I was in middle school. Like I was a kid. I don't even remember how young I was. And that continued throughout art high school and throughout art school college. And then I went for a master's degree in creative writing, and I was living in Brooklyn, New York shortly after graduating with my master's. And much like any normal person, I was up at 3 a.m. Surfing Craigslist, which doesn't sound problematic, but that's sort of where you find yourself at a lot of times when you work in creative gigs, is just in between gigs, constantly looking for something to either fill your pockets for the next month of rent or stimulate your creativity. Because, I mean, you know, at the time in Brooklyn, I was living in this shared loft, and my bedroom was just a makeshift box, you know, made of 10 square feet of plywood. I mean, I was quite literally the definition of a starving artist. So that was what I did for fun. I would just sort of browse. At one point, I found on Craigslist a casting call by Caroline Spiegel and her team for erotic voice performances. And I, at first, I had no idea what that meant. So I asked them if I could take a look at what it is that they have on their site. Hold on one moment. I asked them if I could take a look at what they have on their site, and they graciously sent me over a couple samples or their platform. I don't really remember. It's been years. And I listened to it, and I thought, you know, I think maybe I could try this, because it's really intriguing. And that intrigue hasn't left me since I started in 2017. You know, I think what's so profoundly amazing about this platform and about the people behind it is that it's not something that was created selfishly. This is a platform that is meant to be a safe place for everyone to just explore themselves without the necessity of this voyeuristic comparison to others in media, which is really, it's really healthy. When I was younger, I personally struggled a lot with over comparing myself to men in in traditional quote unquote pornography, and I think it's kind of revolutionary that this sort of adult content is here now, and I don't think we've even seen it at its apex. I mean, this is such a healthy thing for people. It's one of those things where it's like you wish that you had thought of that, because it's really brilliant. Anyway, so I submitted a clip of my voice to them, just talking like a normal person, and I also submitted a clip saying something sultry or seductive. I haven't listened to it since I sent it to them, so honestly, I would probably cringe incredibly if I heard it now. But it seems that they saw some potential, something in me. So they let me start creating for them. And I chose the name Bad Influence because I needed a name. I honestly, as I've said before, I did not think it would stick, but I'm happy that it sort of informs people to the kind of work they can expect from me. All right, moving on. Let me get another drink here. Oh, I think a train is about to pass. Hold on. Yep. I don't know if you can hear that on the microphone. There we go. Get on out of here. Go. Scat. Come on. Go. All right. I see the caboose. That should be the title of my next audio. I see the caboose. Okay. All right. Rewarding myself with another sip of tea. Okay. Second question. What do I like doing in my spare time when I have it? Holding a dog, honestly. Obviously, that would be my own usually, but I do love all dogs. One of the younger moments in my life that my parents tell me about was when my father brought us to a public park, my siblings and myself. And while my siblings went to the playground, my father quickly lost track of me because I was running towards the street to cross it to a dog that was wagging its tail. I've just been a dog person my whole life. I like hanging out with dogs, playing interactive games that either have a narrative or in which I can imagine one while I play. I like axe throwing. I like dabbling in different things with my hands, like smithing or glass torch work, anything. I love playing with stringed instruments. I'm not nearly as talented musically as, say, Sarah on Quinn, but I do like to play. I like cooking. I like knitting. I need to pare down my hobbies. I don't have enough time for that. yeah, that's my answer to that. Let me get another sip of tea. let's see. What is the most interesting thing that I have read or seen this week? Well, this week, what have I been reading and watching? I finished Silence in Her Eyes this week, which was a very frustrating read. No shade if you like the book. I was reading it on a whim, and I think there's a lot of lost potential. I have been watching Blue Eye Samurai, and for the filmmaking nerds out there, I've been really just awestruck at the artistry of the mise-en-scene and the animation and the set pieces and just all of the crafts work that has gone into that. I mean, really, if you look deeper into that project, it's not just an animation. They did a lot of rotoscoping stuff. It's really cool. So highly recommend. The writing is also really brutal and top tier. It really explores gray areas of morality, which I am sure people know I love exploring in my audios and stories. Moving on. Let me drink some more tea. Okay, let's see. Let's be honest. My old days. Wake up. Oh, that's really sweet. What inspires you, either on those days or every day? You know, inspires is a really tough word for me when it comes to day to day, because I share this sometimes on AMAs or Q&As. I do have anxiety and depression that I manage. You know, I feel like I do a pretty good job with, but I think that on days like that, the only thing that keeps me moving, I wouldn't really consider inspiration. I think it's this sense of knowing that the world around me is gonna keep moving with or without me. So I've got to decide, am I on or off the bus today? Because, I mean, the inspiration for me, artistic inspiration and inspiration to really gain momentum in whatever I'm doing is going to come for me after I start moving. And, I mean, in regards to inspired, things that inspire me, I am inspired hearing of the effects that my work, that other people's work on this platform has had on some people. It's really profoundly inspiring and moving, and makes me want to always keep making better stuff, which unfortunately is kind of double-edged because it means I'll have more pressure on my head. But that is an answer for another day. Next question. Hold on one moment. So much throat clearing. I read recently that I'm not supposed to clear my throat, that for voice acting, I should learn to just keep swallowing, which, hey. Okay. I don't like labels. Do I ever just one thing? Oh, lovely. What are a few things that define you, or that you feel like define you? Wow. I don't know. You're giving me an existential crisis here. I have no idea. You tell me. I think, I'd like to define myself with curiosity and compassion. I recently got a piece of artwork done on my body that was a reference to a game that I played that reignited this sense of curiosity in me. I was always a terrible student in public school, and I never really saw the excitement in being curious, in learning, and in gaining knowledge. And this particular game, it's called Outer Wilds, really reminded me what can be thrilling about the pursuit of knowledge, what can be thrilling about letting your curiosity grow and actually committing to that curiosity, which is completely unrelated to the question. I think I'd like to define myself with curiosity and compassion. Yeah. Another drink of tea. Isn't this the hot content that your listeners come here for? Do you have coffee in the morning from the same mug each time? Do you have a snack before bed? What is your wake up to go to bed ritual? This is a cheat. This is three questions. All right. I do not have coffee in the morning. I don't do coffee anymore. It's too much for my anxiety. I drink tea in the morning in whatever receptacle I can find, no particular mug. And before bed, I don't know. If I do have a snack, I usually like a protein bar, because protein rich foods don't they sustain your appetite for longer. Otherwise, I found that I can sometimes wake up hungry in the middle of the night, like a ravenous goblin, and go to the kitchen and eat just a whole bunch of junk food. So I guess something rich in protein. Yeah, that's my answer to that. Another sip of tea, if you can even handle it. If anyone is wondering, by the way, the tea brand I believe is Harney and Sons, and it is called Paris, the flavor. It is my mainstay. So, good hand lotion, random cough drops. What are three small things I always have around me? Three small things I always have around me. Well, I could be cheap and just say the three rings I have on right now. My keys, I have a keychain that hangs on my hip. I usually like to have a lighter to fidget with, or my practice balisong, butterfly knife, and then my rings. So yeah, whatever combination of those I can gather in my tired brain in the morning. Anyway, moving along. I really hope this mic is sounding okay, because anyway. Full transparency, I can give great advice. Blah, 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 blah. Give advice to other people if it relates to me. what is the best piece of advice I have ever received so far? The best piece of advice I have ever received in my entire 31 years of existence was from my father, and he's never gonna know it. Because I don't think he even realized that it was important to me when he said it. It was just something he said, and it stuck with me. And I think if I asked him if he remembered that, he would not remember. I had recently broken up with someone because I was particularly struggling managing my life and my mental state, and I didn't want them. I couldn't bear to have them feel like I was a burden on them. So we had only been dating for a couple months, but I felt myself falling in love with this person. And so I ended it, and I went home and fell to the floor of my bedroom crying. And I just couldn't stop. I could not stop crying for hour and a half, 2 hours, I don't know. I don't know how long it was. And my dad called just out of nowhere, I think to ask if I was watching the Super Bowl or something. It might have happened during Super Bowl weekend. It was very bad timing for him because he doesn't want to give fatherly advice at that point. And I just, he could tell that I was crying, and I explained the situation and told him that I didn't know if I made the right choice. And my dad, to paraphrase what he said something along the lines of, "Listen, whatever decision that you made, maybe it's right, maybe it's wrong, but the important thing is you made it. Maybe it is wrong, who knows, but making a choice is so much better than letting the world choose for you. So live by it, The fact that you made the choice makes it the right choice, in that moment, so to speak. So, yeah. I also would never tell him that because it would go right to his head. All right, more tea. Spilling the tea, but I would never dare because I want to drink it all. Okay, next up. As I've gotten older and wiser and lived a little, I would tell my younger self not to fear at failing at something. What advice would I give my younger self? I don't think my younger self would listen to anything I would have to say. I was kind of a moron. I think when I was younger, I had this innate sense that I knew what to expect. I kind of felt like I knew what everything felt like, and I knew what the future held and everything like that. And because of that, I was kind of a cocky jerk. I mean, I did a lot of growing, and unfortunately, that ended up circumstantially happening through some pretty rough experiences in my romantic life and interpersonal relationships, but I think those experiences gave me perspective. They opened my eyes to realizing that the world is never done surprising you. But that's a whole other tangent I could go into. Those problematic times in my life that I kind of had to go through. So I don't know. I don't think I would give any advice. Maybe I'd smack myself upside the head, honestly. I think if I met my younger self, I would think he was a fucking douche. Yeah. Everyone is beautiful in their own way. Beauty can be attitude, personality, self-confidence, depth of thought, beautiful, a feeling. What do I find beautiful in others? At this point in my life, I find unconditional kindness, friendliness without any pretense or agenda to be the most endearing, the most beautiful qualities in anyone. It's just not as common as it should be, and it's moving when someone is just a nice person to other people. I mean, I'm not saying that to be beautiful, everyone has to be Mr. Rogers, but it couldn't hurt to aspire to just be nice to each other and be nice to ourselves. Because I think that the divisive nature of the times in which we live really profits off of us kind of loathing ourselves. I hope that's not getting too hashtag deep. I don't know. Okay, let me get some tea and go to the next question. It is the new year. Oh, yeah, it is the new year. Well, I don't necessarily believe in resolutions. I do believe in fresh starts and big adventures. What are you most excited about at this time in your life? I am excited to go to sleep and maybe wake up and eat a couple Lindt chocolates and go back to sleep. I like to keep my resolutions pretty granular, or they sort of fall off when I don't live up to them. I look forward to working out today, but I'm afraid that if I am excited to get swole, which let's be real, I'm a lanky dude, I'm never gonna be swole. I'm just setting myself up to give up. So I don't know. Today I'm excited to go home and pet my good boy and watch some trash TV and work out. So yeah. More tea, if you can believe it, more tea. This is one of the behind the scenes things that people don't know about recording, that I don't know if other creators do this. Maybe I should ask. But I do drink tea throughout the process because it really keeps the richness of my voice, healthy and moving. But anyway, I like positive affirmations. Oh, yeah, good. Putting that energy out into the world. A favorite of mine is I'm allowed to take up space, have desires, and have that voice. It's true. What is a favorite affirmation of mine that I can share? I've been wanting to come up with a good affirmation for a while. Every time that I, stand in front of a mirror and try to generate something, I usually end up turning it into a character or an impression from a movie or something. I'm too goofy to look at myself in the eyes with sincerity. I like the phrase my swimming instructor used about the deep end when I was trying to pitch up my swimming skills. He just would keep looking at me when I was nervous and say, like, "Hey, don't worry about it. It's the same water. There's just more of it." So, I mean, I guess transposing that to real life, if you feel like you're waking up and the day is just weighing on you, there's so much, same water, there's more of it. Just take it step by step. It's fine. There's nothing to be worried about. As far as positive affirmations, like I am looking for a good one. So if people have recommendations, please leave them in the comments down below. I don't know. Like, comment, and subscribe. I'm gonna get another drink of tea. What is, okay, having never recorded an audio in any form or fashion, Zoom chats do count. What is my routine before recording an audio? Oh, vocal warm-ups, mic testing, blood sacrifice, usual. I don't really have a before recording routine. I mean, I down a full caffeinated cup of tea, but it's not something that there's nothing that I've ubiquitously done throughout my entire body of work before recording. I sort of try and improvise new ways to jump into it because I'm always hoping that I'll find a more effective way to do it. I know that's sort of a cop out of an answer. So I'm just going to take another sip. Given the nature of the type of audios you record, it can all goes, it can't all, let me try that again. Given the nature of the type of audios you record, it all can't go smoothly every time, right? Can you share a hilarious behind the scenes moment that happened while recording? Honestly, I don't, I've been recording for like several years, and I wish I had journaled about the times that I made myself laugh because I know I have, but honestly, I don't think I have any really good stories off the cuff. I know that there have been times when I've been hungry and recording, and I'll wait for my stomach to make a noise, and then I'll start moaning again, and then every time I start to moan, my stomach would make a noise. But I feel like that's more just frustrating than hilarious. So yeah. Sorry, I wish I could be more interesting. next question. Okay, pretty much my entire life, I've been quite shy in person, painfully so sometimes. People assume that I am standoffish or rude. Once they get to know me, though, it's almost comical how surprised they are by who I really am. Yeah, you got all of those secretly big personalities, man. What's the funniest slash strangest misconception someone has had about me? I can't say for sure when it comes to people who have formed misconceptions of me on Quinn. I do know that in real life, a lifelong struggle since middle school because of my voice, funny enough. A lot of people have assumed that I am a pothead. I've met some of my better friends in life by them trying to make friends with me because they thought I was a drug dealer. Best way I've heard myself described physically was secondhand. It was a girl talking to a close friend of mine, trying to get them to set us up on a date, saying that, you know, with my tattoos and broody demeanor, I simultaneously look like a troublemaker and a lanky cartoon character that actually wouldn't hurt a fly. So I I think that misconceptions, I'm not a very good first impression person. I used to say I'm allergic to first impressions, because I get all flustered like this. So I'm just going to shut myself up by putting tea in my mouth. I am positive one of the most asked questions you've probably gotten is, has anyone recognized your voice while you're out living your life? Do you have any funny stories of trying to stay incognito in public? No. I think that that's not, respectfully, I think that's not my level of fame. You know, that's like Will Arnett or Rosamund Pike, or that's their levels of fame where, you know, they have such huge followers that, you know, people who speak other languages exclusively still can recognize their voice in a crowd. I don't know. I've never been worried about it just because there are a lot of people out there. Yeah. So when all is said and done, I want people to remember me as someone they can trust, someone who always had their back and would go to bat for them. That's good. What would you like to be remembered for? I don't know. I mean, I feel a little weird about thinking beyond when I've left this body. Feeling remembered, I think sometimes cosmically can feel kind of trivial. But I grew up and still am kind of a social chameleon. So I guess I'd feel best if people thought of me as someone they could feel at ease being themselves around. I think that's sort of a point of pride for me, is making people feel like they're not judged when they're around me. And I usually make that environment by debasing myself first in front of them, so that they don't have to feel like we're in competition, or like there's any, like, who am I to judge? Yeah, I hope that's a good answer. I don't know. All right, let me take another sip. I see we're coming up near the end here. We are almost done, I promise, although I could keep chatting for hours. When you think about your fans and listeners, what is one message I want to give directly to fans or listeners? Please, please be nice to you, even if sometimes you feel like you shouldn't be, even if sometimes you feel embarrassed just to be you. Life as a human is so overwhelmingly, cosmically humorless and terrifying, and in that deluge of chaos and fear and pain, the least you can do for yourself and for people around you is just be nice to yourself. Do something nice for yourself. Let yourself feel good about something, you know, even if that's just listening to an audio and escaping for a few minutes. In my life, I've had a lot of self-loathing. You know, thankfully, I'm better at managing my mental state these days, but it, you know, it's not uncommon, and I think often the worst company for a lot of people can be themselves. So just please, do something nice to yourself today for me, I guess, if you want. I'm not your boss. Okay, quickly before I lose you, answer these rapid-fire questions. Ah, fuck, here we go. All right. What are three things always in your fridge? Parmesan, Romano, and cheddar cheese. I like cheese. Most recently, my eyes have been opened to shredding, like, actual blocks of cheese instead of buying the pre-shredded, and how much of a world of difference fresh Parmesan is. Anyway, cats or dogs? Dogs, come on. You seen dogs? They're just always dogs. Salty or sweet? Sweet. I like sweet things. Learn by watching or learn by doing? I say learn by doing, unless it involves, like, surgery or something. Cannonball into a pool or dip a toe in first? You know, I like to pretend that I'm slipping in, so the lifeguard has to come over and cuddle me. I don't know. Anyway, going into a pool is fantastic. So anyway, you want to go in, it's great. Let's see. Finally, it wouldn't be me and my Instagram page if I didn't ask you, what are your top three favorite, most memorable comments from any of your audios? Holy shit, dude. I don't know. It's been over 100 and I think 70 audios, and so many comments are so good on these. I adore all of them. I've read every single comment on every audio, believe it or not, and there have been ones that have made me laugh so fucking hard. But I can't recall them off my head because there's too many clever people in the comment sections. I don't know. So yeah, I guess that's it. Listen, I want to thank Comments on Quinn for sitting down with me, and thank you to my listeners. Thank you, kittens, for listening to my voice and letting me borrow you for short amounts of time in your life, because I know it's precious, and maybe even if you don't feel like it is, I feel like it is. And the words that I put into this microphone have no meaning without you interpreting them and letting me in. So that's all I've got, and my cup of tea is completely empty, so I need to go make another one. That's all I've got. Thank you for having me, and thank you for listening, guys. All right, bye bye.